Thank you so much, and we wish Jen good health and a quick recovery. You did a great job.
Oh, thanks.
Covering for her.
Yeah, thank you.
She's been very, very conscientious of putting this really fabulous series together. I don't know if there are too many series like this, Pastor Gary, around. Congratulations, and congratulations on this church. All that you're doing, and given that what you said about half the folks here aren't members, right? Excellent resource to the community. As you heard in the introduction, I've been an urban pastor for many, many years. Now I'm a suburban pastor. I feel guilty. I always respect good urban ministry, Pastor Gary, so congratulations and blessings. There are also a couple of books that Jim ordered for you, and if you want them, just pay Pastor Gary, right? I think one's 19 and one's, what did we say,
27? 27.95.
But round it up a nickel,
yeah.
All right?
So you
didn't have to deal with change. They will have a lot of the material that I present to. This one, The Catholic Luther, just came out last week on November 20th. So I think you're the first ones to get this book. Hot off the press. The other one has been out for a while. You probably, Pastor Gary knows, and others of you might know, I would say a generation ago, this would have been heresy. The Catholic Luther, you know, or Luther's spirituality. Because a lot of Lutherans sort of adopted the kind of American Protestant view of the world, which was emptied of spirituality, right? Emptied of good, not, I wouldn't say piety, because you know Lutherans were very pious, but of good spiritual traditions. I mean, let me just give you an example. When I grew up in New England, I was born in Brooklyn, but we moved up to New England, and when I'm going to be a little silly here for a minute. I don't want you to take this seriously. When we boys would play baseball, my Catholic friends would always cross themselves, right? And they'd get a hit, right? And I'd get up as a good Protestant and would strike out, right? So I said to myself, what is this, right? And so I always wanted to learn how to cross myself, right? And then only later now Lutherans can do it, right? We're actually grown into sort of traditional pious symbols that of our faith. The point is that Luther never lost that. Right? But what happened is that Lutheranism, as it became more Protestant, shed a lot of that spirituality and piety. And so to be a good Protestant was to be anti-Catholic, right? Which Luther never was, as this book is titled. He was Catholic and did not want to cause a schism, but he indeed saw that as a result of his reforms, but he was just part of a long history of reform in the church, right? He unfortunately was part of one that ricocheted off the church for many, many generations and centuries. The Roman Catholic Church just absorbed reform, and for a number of historical reasons, in the late Middle Ages and at the time of the Reformation, reform ricocheted off the church. There are a number of reasons for that. That's not my topic. But he did not want to split the church. That just happened as a result. Now, 500 years later, as you can see from some of the books that are in the back, or some of the books that we're publishing now, the traditions are coming together again. And Luther is beginning to be seen by the Roman Catholic Church as a Catholic reformer. as part of the Catholic tradition. And the Oxford Confession, which is the great confession of the Lutheran Church, is being seen as part of Catholic theology, good Catholic theology, good Catholic Reformed theology. So both traditions are coming together again. My topic is Mary and the Saints. And what Lutherans need to do is reappropriate, some do, right? Some do it very well in traditions that we call evangelical Catholic. A lot of churches up in this area are evangelical Catholic. Evangelical, you know, sort of coming from the German sense of being focused on the gospel, not that the Catholic Church isn't, right? But in German, it's evangelisch, are the Lutherans. And then Catholic, right, meaning we're part of the universal church. So we're beginning to reappropriate what was lost at the height of Protestantism, especially in the 19th century. And part of that is Mary. A Lutheran once came to me, and who was a former Roman Catholic, and he said, you know, I frequently say, you know, Hail Mary, full of grace, blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Is that a problem? Is that all right? I told him, why, sure. There's nothing wrong with it. It's biblical.
Yeah.
Right? That's exactly from the scriptures. So she's eating right now, so I'll call on Deva first, all right, to read to us from Luke. And while you're looking at it, let us begin with prayer, now that I did this long introduction. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, in choosing the Virgin Mary to be the mother of your Son, you made known your gracious regard for the poor, the lowly, and the despised. Grant us grace to receive your word in humility, and so to be made one with your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
So let's hear this something about Mary. Remember that movie?
Yes.
As a pastor, I didn't see it. But Pastor Gary laughed. He must have seen it. No, I didn't see it.
This is a reading from the Gospel of Luke, the first chapter, verses 26 through 45. Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 45. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, The child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord.
So, you know, most, a good portion of you are Roman. How many of you here are Roman Catholic? Awesome. So, and how many of you here are Lutheran or Protestant? So, when Protestants hear this text, you're going, why is he reading that? That's a Christmas text, right? That's what we hear in Advent, right? And then we forget about Mary after that, right? Unless we were formerly Roman Catholic, like my friend, who said that every time he's in trouble, you know, he prays, and he also says it's all right to use the rosary, and of course it is. It's just a mechanism, you know, for a tool for prayer, right? For a tool for concentration, you know, to be able to focus. It's a centering prayer. For Roman Catholics, so you know, but Protestants hear that, and it's sort of all right. You know, after Christmas, now we get on with life, right? Now we go on with other. And Mary is not a part of their piety, unless we were formerly Roman Catholic. For Roman Catholics, it's part of the piety. What I want to share with you today is that Luther had a Marian piety. So he, when he first was was struck by lightning, right? He calls on Saint Anne. Now the Catholics will know who's Saint Anne.
The grandmother of Jesus,
right? I brought pictures. I'll set out later. You know that Luther grew up with Saint Anne. She was the patron saint of miners, and his father was a miner, right? So he appeals to Saint Anne, and he would have seen iconography, pictures of Mary, you know, all around. That's part of what's happened in Lutheran churches too. Not here. Look at how beautiful this is. You know, Pastor Gary has done a wonderful job, but we've almost kind of like denuded ourselves, right? You know, of the iconography. Thank God we still have stained glass windows, but there are a lot of Protestant churches that don't even have those.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, we don't.
Why? Because, yeah, you know, you don't want to practice idolatry. As if honoring Mary, the mother of God, is practicing idolatry. There's something wrong with this picture, right? But we moved in a way, for all kinds of reasons, you know, away from Luther's piety. So let's think of some other things about Mary. She We hear about her again when Jesus is at the temple, right? So she was his mother, you know. He got lost, like any good adolescent, right? And she worries about him. He's at the wedding at Cana, right? Remember, you know, she, like a good mother, you know, tells the stewards, right? Do whatever he tells you, right? And he protests, but, you know, does it anyway, you know, as any good son will do. We also, you know, hear about her at the cross and resurrection. And I asked Patty to read something that from the Book of Acts, which I actually learned in writing this book. Let's.
Okay, this is from Acts chapter 1, beginning 12th verse. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers.
So, what do we learn from that, right, in the scriptures, that Mary was at the very center of the early New Testament church, right? So she's the heroine of the gospel, right, of Luke, right? Who's the hero of the other nativity story that we have in Matthew? Who do we hear more about in Matthew? This sort of a, pardon? No, in the nativity story. Joseph, right? Joseph is the one, you know, who doesn't put her away and all that. He has the dream, right? But Luke lifts up Mary, right? And so, as you know, Luke is also the author of the book of Acts, right? So Mary is at the beginning. Mary is there throughout in the Gospel of Luke, and is especially at the cross, right? But she's also a witness to the resurrection of Jesus. She's, you know, the disciples all fled, remember?
Yeah.
It's the women, right?
Yes.
One of my teachers once said, don't take this wrong, Pastor Gary, but the church has always been a women's movement that has propped up male egos. The men aren't applauding. But, so the women were at the cross, right?
Yeah.
And where were the men? Hiding,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Just like
yeah.
they're usually doing on Sunday morning. So Mary then is also right at the center of the early church. So you have a sense then that she is an enormously important figure in the scriptures. And so the question is then, why, right, would we not lift her up, celebrate her, which is done around the world? We frequently think of appearances of Mary. You've heard of that, right? That Mary appears.
Yes.
What century? This is a trick question. What century do you think there have been more appearances of Mary than any other century in the history of the Christian Church? 20th century. There have been more reported appearances of Mary in the 20th century. And that would go on into the 21st century. So we think of Mary maybe in a medieval sense, right? Or in a Catholic sense pre-Reformation, but that's only because we don't know enough about the global church, right? Of how Mary is celebrated, for example, in Mexico or in Poland, or David and I were speaking before about India, right? And I didn't even know that where I taught in Bangalore, India, which is in southern India, there's even a bigger celebration on the feast day of Mary than one that I attended in Chennai. Used to be called Madras, right? And there were so many people on the feast at the feast of Mary that you could not move, which is not unlike India anyway, right? But then this was just simply on a feast day. There were so many. But this is India, right? And when I spoke to the priests afterwards at the festival, they told me both Hindus and Christians come to that feast. So Mary is this universal figure, right? That oftentimes we have just left out of our piety as Protestants, and as the traditions come closer together, we have to reclaim it. And why? That's my topic today. And what I'd like to do is talk about Mary first, and then we'll move to all the saints, because she's sort of an example of how Luther understood saints and sainthood in the church. Let us all turn. Not everybody will have this green book but to page 147. It's not hymn number 147, but page number 147, because we heard read from the Gospel of Luke, but I deliberately didn't have read what was the center of Luther's Marian theology and piety, namely the Magnificat, right? And I understand you do evening prayer here at Grace, and the Magnificat is in the evening prayer service, right? Let's read it together. Did everybody find page 147? It's at the beginning of the book. I won't ask you to sing it.
We know it.
Okay, so let's say it together. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he who looked for his holy servant, from this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. So, there you have the Magnificat, around which Luther's theology of Mary was built. So that is the core. I gave you this sort of wide-ranging introduction to Mary, right? But it's not Mary as a figure who is important in the Bible that was crucial for Luther, but it was the Magnificat that was the core. And that's in this book here, Luther's Spirituality. He wrote a commentary on the Magnificat, My Soul, that's just short for My Soul Magnifies, right? He wrote a commentary on that for his prince, Prince Frederick. And he wanted the commentary to serve as a kind of model of the way the prince should serve his people. Would that our politicians would know that now, right? To care for the lowly, right? To care for those who are in need. Luther thought that the prince should make his principality one big hospital for all those who are in need. In those days, they had hospitals. Hospitals were places to which people went for medical care or for other care. But his understanding of what the prince should do is make the whole principality a hospital for everyone. It's kind of a modern notion of the state caring for its people and not leaving, you know, the people to be cared for just by the church or just by charities, but the state itself was responsible for that. And he uses the Magnificat as the source for that. And the crucial part, again, this is from this sense of Mary seeing that God looked upon the lowly comes out strikingly in this at the very beginning of his commentary. And let me read this to you. Just as God is called the Creator and the Almighty because the world was created out of nothing, so God's work goes on unchanged. From now to the end of time, God will make what is insignificant, despised, suffering, and dead into something valuable, honorable, blessed, and alive. On the other hand, everything that is valuable, honorable, blessed, and living, God will make to be nothing, worthless, despised, suffering, and dying. No creature can make something out of nothing. But God can make something out of nothing. That's what he's alluding to. Therefore, God's eyes peer only into the depths, not to the heights. And he quotes Daniel to support that. and goes on, who is like the Lord our God, who is seated on high, who looks far down on the heavens and the earth? Because God is most high with nothing above, God cannot look above or alongside. Just think of the Trinitarian God, right? Because God is God, God can't look above, right? Or alongside. And since nothing is God's equal, God must necessarily look within, that is, to the Trinity, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and below. And the farther you are below, the better God sees you.
That's why I'm so short.
There you go. I was the shortest kid in school, and I would have helped me if I had known that passage when I was the smallest kid in school. But isn't that lovely, right?
Yeah.
Because God can't look above God, and God doesn't look alongside, but only within. You know, so the conversation of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, right? The mutual relations of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the love among the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So God does look within, but God looks down upon us. And the farther one is, if you're depressed, right?
Yeah.
You know, if you're down, if you're poor, if you're hungry, God sees you know, all the more clearly. So what Luther wanted to tell the prince is, that's your job, prince. Look at what Mary knew already, right? In the Magnificat. Mary knew how God is. She knew the God of the Old Testament and the God of Jesus, and witnessed to that God. It is a God who loves and cares for the lowly. Well, what else does Mary represent? For Luther, Mary represents faith, right? So it's not you know, Mary as a person that Luther is lifting up, right? As if she would become some kind of female goddess, right? No, it's the faith of Mary that is an example for us. And what does that mean? Mary listens, right? Well, who doesn't listen in that passage that David read for us that just precedes the Annunciation to Mary? The priest doesn't listen, right? Zechariah, right? Mm-hmm. He mocks the angel who says that his wife, right, Elizabeth, would conceive a son, and he's struck dumb. Isn't that, Pastor Gary, that's kind of rough on us, right? Those of us who are supposed to be articulate and proclaim, right, we are struck dumb at times in the face of Mary, you know, the lowly maiden, who simply acknowledges the gift. That doesn't mean she doesn't have questions, right? How can this be? She asks, right? But she, according to Luther, she understands who God is.
Yeah.
She listens, she's obedient, and she is a person of faith, and she knows that God acts through her. My soul magnifies the Lord. Mary also knows how to praise, right? Oftentimes, I bet you are here, but Lutherans in particular are not very good at praising, right? I had a colleague years ago, I used to teach at the seminary, right? And he said, you know, it's perfectly all right for me to worship God with my ears. And what he meant was, I could sit like this, he was a good German, I can sit like this in church, right? And listen, right? Nothing with the body, right? God forbid that he gesture, right? Or praise, or pray. You get it, right?
Yeah.
Mary knows how to praise, like Miriam. You know, that's what Mary's, in Hebrew, Mary's name is Miriam. So just like Miriam sang in the Old Testament, the Miriam of the New Testament sings and praises God for what God has done for her. not what she does. It's not, that's Luther's sense of Mary. It's not what she does, but what God has done for her. But this becomes even more important because now you all know this, you know, by heart in the Creed, right? We say of Jesus what? That he is born of
the Virgin.
You know it all by heart, right? Well, what does that mean? You know, for Luther, it means, because he understood the creeds and comments on them here, that as we learn from the ancient church, she is the Theotokos. She is the God-bearer. She bears God, you know, himself. Just think of that, right? There's a medieval poem that that goes, you know, she held heaven of all heavens in her womb. Now, I mean, so she held all of the heavens in her womb. So she is the God-bearer, the mother of God, and we shouldn't have a piety about her, right? You know, we shouldn't lift her up as a role model, right? And so I mean, what does it mean that Mary is the Theotokos? Because Mary bears the Christ and God can also be in the church.
Yeah.
Right? There's lots of symbolism in the New Testament about Mary, you know, in some sense being equivalent with the church, right? Now, Protestants, of course, made fun of that, right? Not knowing what they were doing, not knowing how unbiblical they were, right? Because Mary holds God in her womb, the church can hold God as present. Did you follow me?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Because Mary holds God in her womb, the Christ child in her womb, the Christ can be present in the bread and the wine that we share at the Eucharist. Do you follow?
Yeah.
Right? Because the infinite can be present in the material. The finite can hold the infinite because Mary is able to hold the Christ child. The human Mary. It's not again what Mary does, right? It's what God does through her. Is everybody with me?
Yes.
Right? So in some sense, you could do a whole theology of Mary, of how Mary receives God's word, and you can do a whole theology of how we function in faith by listening, right? The great theologian Karl Barth said that you know, we shouldn't get so hung up on her being a virgin. She was a maiden, right? We can go there if we want, that's no problem. But she conceived with her ears. I don't know how you do that. But by listening, it's sort of the power of the oral word, right? I was a pastor in Baltimore for many years, and when people would say to me, they called me the boy pastor. I was a very young pastor. I'm still young. No, anyway. But people would say to me, here, they would make a statement, and then they would say, here, and it took me a long time to understand that when a person older than I would say that, they expected me to obey. Are you with me? Right? It was like, you probably do that with your kids and your grandkids, right? Did you hear me, right? When you're saying, do you hear me, you're not asking, you know, some kind of conceptual question, right? I want to know if you heard me or not, right? You're saying, no, are you going to do it?
Yeah.
Right? And so Mary, Karl Barth wants us to understand that Mary hears, right? And it happens. That's, she's sort of that, in that way, she is a model of faith for us, and a model then of saintliness as well. So she becomes a saint for us. Now, before I move on to saints in general, are there questions about this? And we can go into some more detail. When you teach adults, you always have to leave room for questions. But if you think of anything, raise them. All right. So she is the model of how we are to have faith in God for Luther. She is the model of a person who knows how to praise God, right? As we see here. And for Luther, she is the model of who God is. God looks to the lowly, right? God looks to those who are downtrodden, those who are hungry, and you see that paralleled in the Beatitudes too, which is oftentimes a lesson for All Saints Day. She's also, you know, the model for us of the church itself. Remember, I shared that we can understand how God can be present. A very difficult concept for people today, and we were talking about the postmodern age, right? How can God be present? Well, God can be present in our assembly today, but we see that because God, by God's presence through Mary, according to Luther, that she is the Theotokos, right? That our gathering here today can bear the infinite word as we have fellowship with one another, right? So that we can become the body of Christ. You know that, right? So now we're moving into the next topic, and I'll move there in a moment. We can be the body of Christ even as Mary's body holds the Christ child. And I want you to be... I want you to understand how controversial that was in the early church, because there were men, and men won't understand this because they didn't in the early church, who argued, you know, that Mary was not, in the early church, that Mary was not the Theotokos, the God-bearer, but was the child-bearer. Right, or the Christ bearer, because this is what they said. How could God be part of the messiness of birth? How could God be part of the afterbirth? The theologians, right? The theologians, you know, of whom Luther used, right, and the tradition used, said that's exactly where God is. In the messiness of life. Are you with me? Right? Yes. See, women understand, right?
Yes.
That's where God is. And so when Mary is the Theotokos, right, that means even as you bear all of your pains, right, you have to go and check on your wife, right? See how she is, that we all are bearing, right? As our coordinator Jennifer is not feeling well today, right? As we're bearing the pain of the world, right? We have God present to us. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Right? And that's what we are saying when we say, I believe, you know, in Jesus Christ, born of the Virgin Mary, and then suffered under Pontius Pilate. So we can understand then through this theology of Mary how God is actually present with us in all our sufferings and all our pain. So that was by way of summary. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Now let's move to how he understands the saints. And I have another... tomorrow's All Saints Sunday, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
Let us just... I thought I had that marked. Pastor Gary, is that a separate, it should be, that's right, it would be the Annunciation, Holy Cross Day, Matthew, I had it marked.
Oh.
I'm smarter than I think. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
So my next assignment, we are to talk about the saints. So you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Notice how God is sort of has a female image of a knitter, right? My wife and I had a, when I was a professor of seminary, our pastor was a woman, and she loved that notion of God knitting a people together, all in one piece, mm-hmm. right? What do we say in the creed as well? I believe in the Holy Spirit, right? What's the next line? The Holy Catholic Church. That's what we're going to talk about right now, the communion of saints. What does it mean to be a communion of saints? Now Luther knew that a lot of what was written and said about the saints was legend, but he believed that, like Mary, right, the saints were to be models for us of our faith, and so he tells again from this Luther spirituality book the story in a sermon of Saint Christopher, and he was at the Coburg Castle. This is a picture of the Wartburg, right? But while he was at the Coburg, you know, Luther was a sort of a felon of sorts, right? He could have been killed at any moment after the Diet of Worms. That's not a meal, right? After the Diet of Worms, anybody could have killed him without punishment. So when at the famous Diet, he was at Augsburg. He was hiding away in the Coburg Castle, a different castle, while Philip Melanchthon and others were presenting the Augsburg Confession to the emperor, and it was rejected. But so Luther was kind of suffering at that point, and preaches a sermon on Saint Christopher, and he knew that Saint Christopher, the story of Saint Christopher, was a legend, but he says in this sermon that it has value to us as a story. And you know, Christopher has actually been demoted, right? I don't know why.
They have a lot more new saints, like Teresa Benedict of the Cross, Edith Stein, during the Jewish concentration camps. They added a lot more people into the liturgy, and so some were removed, but not that they would ever be not a saint.
Oh, I see. All right.
Gave more room to the liturgy to have some of these newer people of our century now.
But you can still have them on your dashboard? You can still have the presenters on your dashboard?
She said to the guy about the rosary, perfectly fine.
Thank you. I learned something. But Luther loved the story of St. Christopher. And you know, Christopher means Christ-bearer, right? So even as Mary, right, bears God, Christopher bears Christ. And so he thinks of Christopher, and I'm on page 151, I'm sorry, of this book, Luther's Spirituality. He looks at Christopher as the example of every baptized person. So as I think about myself, and Pastor Gary and I were talking about our early days as parish pastors, now we're seasoned, right? Or at least he is, right? But you know, we were pastors, right? We knew. And what Luther wants to say is everybody in some sense is like that. So that what we do as baptized Christians, right? As we go into life like Christopher, carrying, we are all carrying the Christ child, right? We the mark of Christ on our forehead in baptism, right? We are sealed, you know, by the Holy Spirit, marked for the cross of Christ. And so in our baptismal vocation, we go like Christopher in, you know, carrying Christ as we face this river. So Christopher, you know, full of himself, goes in with the Christ child on his shoulders, thinking, you know, I'm just going to cross this river, and forgets, just like life happens to us, right, that the water is going to go over his head. So he walks down with the Christ child on his shoulders, and the waters swirl, just like life does, right, and goes over his head, and he doesn't know what to do for a moment, until he remembers that he has a staff. And that staff is the cross of Christ. That cross that helps us all through life, has us know as baptismal children of God that God is with us, right? Especially in suffering, which is why this sermon is called The Cross and Suffering on St. Christopher. And right at that point, Luther says, it's not good to drown. I love that. So Christopher's, you know, Christopher's, oh, I could go on and on and on about this. I'll just give you one quick example. There were so many Lutheran churches around the church that I served in Baltimore that the lay people said, they're so close, we could spit on each other. There was a Lithuanian church, there was a Norwegian church, we were talking about this, there was a Finnish church, there was a couple of German churches, a couple of English churches that broke off from the German church. You could just go on and on. Two churches that broke apart because they were drinking beer at the Sunday school. They were literally across an alley from each other because the one group of people felt you should not drink beer at the Sunday school picnic. So they would regularly say, and sometimes we do spit on each other, right? But you know, there were a number of us pastors who were there, and the odds were so against us. Some of the pastors said, you know, we should just pastor these churches to death. That's our role. You've probably heard that before, Gary, right? You know, we should just chaplain them to death. I mean, to that, Luther would say, it's not good to drown, right? That doesn't mean churches don't close, right? I'm not saying that, right? There are some of you are Roman Catholic, you may be part of churches that have closed, right? The bishop had to close, and it's very painful. It's just that what Luther is saying in the Christian life is that's not the plan. Right? The plan is to go down into life and then come up again, like Christopher comes up on the other side, carrying the Christ child. And in this way, experiencing death and resurrection. Sometimes churches close and there's resurrection on the other side in new life, but at least you're not drowning. Are you with me? Right? Sometimes in our own lives, right? That's part of the message of All Saints Sunday, that we go down into life, as Luther would say, and come up them, you know, on the other side. So again, Christopher, even though Luther knows it's a legend, Christopher is a model of the baptismal vocation. You know what I mean when I say vocation? That's sort of our calling, our baptismal calling in life, right? No matter what we do, you know, whether we're teachers or carpenters or homemakers or business people, we all have a baptismal calling in our work, right? And so Saint Christopher, as the Christ bearer, is a model for all of us. And so in this way, the saints are models of faith for us, even as I in particular, you know, we talked about Mary. That doesn't mean that saints are not sinners. Right? Luther had the concept that we are both saint and sinner at the same time. Right? One of my teachers, Eric Rich, said we should not overdo the sinner part of that. And he said sometimes seminarians will, right? That wasn't true of Gary. It was true of me. You get the point? You know, that we are both saint. We are simultaneously saint and sinner. That means if we think we're being saintly, when we're at our best, we're at our worst. Have you ever experienced that in life? Right?
The devil's always tempting us. Right there.
Exactly. The devil always tempts us with our best, not with our worst. The devil always comes to us in a way that makes something seem good, right? That then winds up being evil, right? I was telling Pastor Gary, we have a member of my congregation who's who just made a big mistake, and I asked him what he learned about that, and I was so stunned by the learning of this adolescent that he said what I thought was good and would make me happy turned out to be something that was not good and did not make me happy. You see how that works, right? So we are saints and we are sinners at the same time. The great theologian Augustine said we are part saint and part sinner. Luther said no, we're simultaneously saint and sinner at the same time, so that we're always sinful in the face of God, but we are at the same time created in the image of God, and we can live out of that image, right? Having heard the good news, love neighbor, you know, love the world, care for the world, and not just be cynical about, but you follow, right? Mm-hmm. Not just be cynical about who we are, because then that just leads to a kind of nihilistic understanding of, or a cynical understanding of life that is not at all productive. And that then is not only true for us in Luther's understanding of the individual, but also of us as a communion, right? That we believe in the communion of saints. It means communio. The Greek word is koinonia, the fellowship of saints. And for Luther and for the whole tradition, we understand what Paul says in Corinthians to mean that we are the body of Christ. As the communion of saints, we are the body of Christ. So, you know, I ask you, I mean, what does that mean, right? If you are the body of Christ, that means you commune, you share in the Eucharist, right, in the Lord's Supper, and as Augustine said, you are what you eat. You are the body of Christ. And that means that you then witness to the communities around you here in Bayonne, you know, as the crucified and resurrected Christ. That doesn't mean that as a communion you aren't sinful, right? As an institution, you're both sinful and saintly at the same time. But in that presence, you are a witness to the crucified and resurrected Christ. And in some sense, that's all the community sees of God is you. Isn't that scary?
Yes.
If you are the body of Christ, that doesn't mean that Christ is not more than you are, because he is the universal Lord, right? But he's no less than you are. You follow?
Yeah.
You are the body of Christ. And so therefore then, you are in communion with the saints, both living, right? And that's the real sense of it, that you are the living saints, right? And the theology of the saints then provides that for you, but also in communion with the saints who have passed away. Now, Lutherans will frequently, you know, ask me, you know, well, Catholics pray to the saints. You know,
excuse me, we get our prayers answered also.
Did you hear what she just said?
Yeah. Yep.
And they answer too. But here's the Lutheran understanding of saints and communion, right? Yeah. Now, and prayer. Do you ask one another to pray for you? So why wouldn't you ask the saints who are alive in God to pray for you?
Exactly.
Are you with me?
Yes.
So someone in your family is sick, right? And you say, pray for me, right? Why wouldn't you ask Mary to pray for you? Why wouldn't you ask Peter to pray for you, right? Why wouldn't you? You understand?
Yeah.
Why would? Pardon?
But I'm saying you don't have to intercede. You can go to the top.
I go to the top.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, but why do you? Why do you? What's your friend's name beside you?
It's Kim.
Kim?
Yeah.
Why do you ask Kim to pray for you? Why don't you go right to the top?
Why ask Kim too?
Pardon?
I ask her, but I ask him too.
There you go. But Kim's prayers for you are what we call intercessory prayers. All right. That's praying that she's interceding for you, which is all that we're asking the saints to do as well, to intercede for us. And Luther's understanding, I have another topic, right, of prayer in February, but maybe not all of you will be able to make it. It'll probably be snowy and cold and all that. We won't be as many people. But Luther said in his famous treatise, which is at the end of this book on prayer, that we are to hang on God's ear when we pray. Hang on his ear. What is so amazing about that is if you look in the Old Testament, I don't expect you all to know this, but Elijah mocks the priests of Baal, right? Some of you are nodding, right? Because they're trying, and he says, are you trying to wake God up, right? Are you going to try to wake your God up? And of course, as soon as Elijah does his ritual, you know, the burnt offering burns, right? But Luther almost does the same thing that Elijah criticizes the priests of Baal for, you know, to sort of wake God up, right? You know, so as my teacher, Robert Jensen, would always say, you know, if I want Jones to get well, I'm going to say to God, God, make Jones well. Are you with me?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And if it means I've got to appeal to Mary and I've got to appeal to Peter and, you know, and appeal to Paul and, you know, all the saints, I want God to make Jones well. Now, God may have other things in mind, but that doesn't mean as a community, right?
Yeah.
We don't, as a communion of saints, we don't pray. You see, there are some people who understand this notion of prayer as that which changes us. Do you get that? If I pray, what my prayer is simply to submit myself to the will of God. It's a perfectly appropriate way of understanding prayer. It wasn't Luther's. You know, Luther's understanding of prayer, because that's going to happen anyway. Right? Thy will be done. And that we're saying, you know, please, you know, I know your will is going to be done, right? But I want my will to be your will, right? But I also want God, you, to do that which I need. And so where we started out, namely with Mary, right? Mary knowing that God looks into the depths. God sees us where we are, right? We can call out, you know, like the great psalm, out of the depths I cry to thee, O Lord, hear my voice. You know, there'd be no reason to say hear my voice if we didn't if we didn't want God to, you know, to listen, right? If we weren't trying to get God to turn to us favorably. And what it is, as we understand the communion of saints, it's a relationship among us, first and foremost, and then a relationship among us and the saints, both living and dead. So just think of that, that when you worship, are you worshiping alone?
No.
No, you're worshiping, you know, as your pastor and priest will share with you, right? With the cherubim and the seraphim, you know, and the church, right? In this world and the next. And that sense of the communion of saints is just that. That we are part of the church universal, right? But also the church transcendent and triumphant. In conclusion, let me just share with you that the modern world, remember I began by saying Protestants kind of emptied their spirituality, their piety, of much of what Luther just took for granted. And contrary to that, Luther's world was filled with the supernatural, with angels, right? With, unfortunately, with demons, you know, in that very castle, he threw a, you know, his ink pot, right? You know, against the wall, you know, because he felt that Satan was tempting him. But his world was filled with a world beyond us. And I don't know if anybody a scientist here, but one of the things that science is learning is that we only now see a fraction of reality. There is a world around us that is, you know, infinitely more complex than in our modern minds that we think about, right? And the ancients or the medievals, and Luther was pretty much a medieval, they were aware of worlds beyond our world. And that world, you know, is made up of the saints, right? The angels. He believed that everybody had a guardian angel, right? An angel who was present to them. My father was a preacher for 50 years, and he would often say to us, "Do you think God is alone?"
No.
Or the other way he'd put it is, "Do you think the only thing God has is us?" Right? Think about that, right? What kind of God would it be if, now, you're very valuable, you're very important, right? Let me just pick on myself. I mean, what kind of God would it be if I was the only part of God's will? Now, I know that God favors me, right? That God loves me, that God has called me by name, but I'm not all there is.
No.
So when we think of Luther's theology of the saints, right? Or his, we could also talk about his theology of angels, or his theology of Mary, right? His world was populated by so much more than we think about in our modern secular world. I'm done.